and we'll talk about assumptions for, you know, a few minutes. So we're going to think about observing these IID pairs, X and Y. Okay, where X are the predictors, they're p-dimensional, and Y are the, let's say, responses, they're just real valued. And in this sequence of lectures, we're going to pay very special attention to this linear model. Where the responses, right, we think are generated by some linear combination of the predictors, where these are the underlying coefficients. So beta is unknown. This is to be estimated. Okay, and the focus in these lectures are going to be cases in which we think this is sparse in some sense, okay, either measured in some norm. And okay, let's just talk a bit about some of our assumptions. Note that we can alternatively write this model more succinctly in this form, okay, where I've written the response vector as y, the error vector as epsilon, and the predictor matrix as x. So x here is n by p, and it has ith row xi. Okay, so this is hopefully very familiar from, you know, 705 and the lectures we did on regression at the start of the semester, et cetera. So, all right, so let's see. What have we assumed so far in writing down this model? So far, really, the only thing I've assumed is that the expected value of the responses given the predictors is a linear function. Okay, some might say, for example, Larry would say this is already a strong assumption, right? It really depends on the data setting, but certainly this is already a strong assumption, right? That the mean is a linear function of the predict, that the mean of the responses is a linear function of the predictors. But we typically have to think, assume even more than that to make progress in some sense in this regression setting when p, the feature dimension, is large compared to the sample size n. So in addition to that, so this is kind of like one assumption that we were making. And then in addition, let's think about our assumptions before we start talking about methods. So there's kind of, as we do in as we said in the nonparametric regression unit, there's kind of two ways to view this. The first is that the predictors are fixed. And actually, I think that high-dimensional regression, in some sense, people tend to flock to this even more so than a nonparametric regression. So a lot of the papers on high-dimensional regression treat the predictors as fixed. So either these are fixed, and we think about these as being, these errors as being, you know, IID with, you know, with mean zero. That's one kind of common assumption we make. Or equivalently to this, as we also remarked in the nonparametric unit, we think about these being random and independent of the errors, right? Okay, so these two things are statistically independent, right? The distribution of the predictors and the errors are independent. And then we condition on the predictors throughout. So what kind of bounds in between these two in our lectures? Whatever's more convenient. For example, when you talk about out-of-sample prediction, you have to think about the x points as being random, because otherwise, you know, I have to think about some typical case of predicting out-of-sample, so I want the x points to be random. But sometimes it's more convenient to treat them as fixed if you look at stuff like in-sample prediction. But these are equivalent, right? Once we condition on the x's, if they're independent of the errors, then the errors being IID you get automatically from the IID pairs assumption, right? The fact that XI and YI were IID. Okay. So any questions about that? That was the same as that we had before, but I just want to make that clear. And lastly, one more assumption that we usually make is that the errors we typically think of as Gaussian or even sub-Gaussian. In fact, there's not really anything special about Gaussian. So sub-Gaussian will be good enough. But something with tails that decay at least as fast as the Gaussian distribution. So these are strong assumptions. Okay. Keep that in mind. Right? We don't always think that somehow every problem we're solving in practice actually fits these, lies into these set of assumptions. But when we're talking about certain properties of estimators, this is like a working ground for showing favorable properties. So if things hold in these kind of idealistic situations, then we may think of that as supporting evidence to use our estimator. But we wouldn't think of that as necessarily holding in every practical problem that we're trying to solve. Okay, so just want to give you a heads up about the strength of these assumptions. And also, it's worth saying that we're looking at a challenging problem. We're going to be focusing on a challenging problem for the most of these lectures. Where P is large. P is large, the feature dimension is large compared to n. Okay, so when I say P is large, I really mean in a relative sense compared to n. And this is what we call high dimensional. Okay, we have a high dimensional regression problem in this case. So in some sense, if we were looking at like a very small, like fixed dimension parametric problem, we may think of this as somehow like rather strong given the setting, but we're going to be looking at a pretty challenging setting. So it's worth keeping in mind that sometimes actually a lot of the results we're going to be making, it may not be possible to make those results without these strong, to prove those results without these strong assumptions. Okay, so let's start off. I figured let's start off with an analysis of least squares to remind ourselves what happens when we don't apply things like sparsity inducing penalties, and we just try to do kind of the classical analysis in that linear model. I found that when I was teaching the nonparametric regression unit, people were surprisingly shy about yelling out stuff like the rates for the risk of the least squares estimator. So I figured we would review that now. So let's talk about least squares. And do a review of its risk properties, and also a review of why it fails in the high dimensional case, just to motivate ourselves to look at other estimators. So we're going to write capital X, although it's kind of hard on the board, but hopefully it'll be clear from the context. These guys will be the columns of our predictor matrix. So these are the variables that we're looking at. Each of these is n-dimensional, whereas when I use lowercase x, each of these will be rows of the predictor matrix. So these will be, for example, for one sample, all the predictor values, and those are n-dimensional. Thank you. P-dimensional, of course. Okay. So. How can we think about the least squares estimator? We can think about it in several different forms. I'll just write down all of them because the notation maybe will help stick if I do so. So the least squares estimator is defined by a minimization problem. We're minimizing over all choices of coefficients beta. And we can write that as the criterion as the sum of the squared values of yi minus xi transpose beta. So kind of matching the notation of our first data model there, finding the coefficients that make this squared loss as small as possible. Or equivalently, we can write this as finding the linear combination of the columns of x or of the predictor variables that make this as small as possible. So this is a sum over observations on the outside. On the inside is a sum over predictors. Okay, or the last way to write it is just in this kind of very succinct matrix notation. Okay, so this should all just be, you know, solidifying notation. So this is the least squares estimator. And of course, we know that when X has full column rank, which means that X1 through XP are linearly independent, then the least squares estimator, the estimate of the coefficients that comes from that problem, is just X transpose X inverse X transpose Y. Okay, this should be, you know, like second nature to you guys at this point, this equation. And okay, this is an easy one, but can this happen? Can X1 through XP be linearly independent when P is larger than N? The feature dimension is larger than the number of samples. Who thinks that that's possible? They can still be linearly independent. Okay, so everyone is on board that by writing this down, this is only true when P is less than or equal to N. It only can be true when P is less than or equal to N. Okay, so this is a low dimensional situation, and that's the estimate of the regression coefficients. So the fitted values, of course, right, then are just, so that's the estimator of the coefficients. The fitted values are what happens when we multiply this by the predictor matrix X, right? So this is X times X transpose X inverse X transpose Y, which is just the projection onto the column space of X times Y. That's this matrix here we can write as PX. It's the projection onto the space span by the columns of X. And these are the predictions that we would make at the sample points, right? If somebody gave you that model and they said, what's the mean of the yi's, and you use least squares, this would be your answer. This is my estimate for the mean of each yi. It's the predictions at the sample points. So this is sometimes called in-sample. And those are our in-sample predictions. And then if you gave me a new point, let's call it x0, right? A new point at which you want to make a prediction, we would form this guy. So that is the vector of xi transpose beta. That's what the matrix x times beta hat is. Those are predictions at the sample points. Here's a new point. Let's call it x0. This is the prediction I'd make. And sometimes we would call this out of sample. And to be honest, this is real prediction. That's not really prediction. It's kind of misnomer, right? So these are fitted values. We use the xi points for training. It's kind of a misnomer to call that a prediction, but we do it anyway. So we call it in-sample prediction, this one out-of-sample prediction. OK, and now let's talk about the risk properties of least squares, just to remind ourselves quickly what we get. So there are two ways of measuring risk in general. I mean, there's more than two, but here are two ways that are natural. And here we're going to assume that x is random. I guess I won't even write that. Okay, we're just going to be thinking about x as being random, because it makes, at least when we talk about out of sample, we will be. Okay, so the first way of measuring risk is just by taking the fitted values, looking at the sum of square distances to the mean, and dividing by n. We can equivalently write this. Sum of squares of these values, right? And we think about the predictors as random. I guess I will write that down just to be clear. So this is an expectation over y and over x. This is actually equal to just what happens at the first point, right? Or really at any point would suffice here, but we can just fix the first point. by symmetry, right? If these are all IID. Okay, so this is what we call in-sample prediction, or in-sample risk, rather, sorry. In-sample risk. So maybe you want to think about it like this. You fix one of the sample points. You ask how well you're estimating the mean at that point. It's actually easier to compute this thing in terms of deriving a risk bound. So we can think about it also in terms of take the whole predictor matrix, multiply it by beta hat, subtract off the mean, compute the L2 norm, okay, and then divide by n. That's the way it's easier to compute it. Then there's also out-of-sample prediction. And that one's kind of rather simple, right? So what we do is we draw a new point x0 from the predictor distribution, independent of the features that we saw for training. And this expectation here is taken over the training data, so xi, yi, and over x0. I'm just collapsing the notation down, not making that explicit. This is called out-of-sample prediction. And as I mentioned, you might actually drop the word out-of-sample and just call this prediction. You know, this is, in a sense, true prediction. Or when we take the expectation, it's risk, out-of-sample risk. So we're going to really quickly run through risk bounds. We're going to compute each of these. Question?
Why are you not taking the expectation is over beta hat minus beta 0? Why is it x?
OK, so why are we not doing this, you're saying? Why is there an x at all?
Yes.
That's a good question. So we could also look at that. That would be a risk in terms of the coefficient estimates, right? So risk in estimating the underlying coefficients. It's just different ways of looking at this the same problem. In terms of prediction, this makes more sense, right? Because when I get a future x, if I want to predict the mean, this is what I'll be doing. And this is kind of a surrogate for that, asking how well you're predicting the mean on the training points. When we talk about the lasso, I'll actually tell you the error, both in terms of the coefficients and in terms of the predictions. One advantage that you have in terms of looking at the predictions is that this makes sense even if the mean wasn't linear, whereas the coefficient error doesn't. So suppose I didn't tell you that the mean was linear. I just asked you how well are you predicting some underlying mean function. In principle, that still makes sense, right? Or out of sample. I asked you how well are you still predicting the underlying mean at x0. In principle, that still makes sense. So we are using a working linear model to estimate the mean. And if we don't think that the mean is actually linear, then really the risk on the prediction scale is the only thing that makes sense, not the coefficients anymore.
The in-sample prediction, are the x's fixed?
They're random.
The random.
I mean, you could think about them either way, because actually it won't depend on the sample points. For fixed, it's not going to be true. This is true, so that's why I said predictors are random. But it's a good question, a good thing to be clear about. This is true when the training points are random by symmetry. But we can compute this when x is fixed or x is random, and we'll get the same answer, actually. OK, other questions? Yeah. Well, this is the risk of the mean, right? Of the mean vector, for example. If we fix if we wanted to call this, for example, mu, right? Or here, this would be the risk of the mean, but evaluated at an arbitrary point that's drawn from the predictor distribution. Yeah, I mean, it's a good point that we can look at the error in our estimator in more than two ways, but on the prediction scale or on the coefficient scale. But if you go back to non-parametric regression, this is the analogy, right? Because we were talking about estimating the mean of the response. This is what we're doing here. This would be like L2 error, right? Because we're integrating out over a new point. OK, all good questions. So how many people can just tell me the answer before I even compute it? What is this going to be? What is this upper bounded by? In terms of a function of P and N, forget about anything else.
P over N, all that squared.
Very close. P over N, unsquared.
Yeah.
And how about this guy? What should it be roughly? Probably roughly the same, right? because these two things probably shouldn't vary too much, differ too much. Would you guess this is larger or smaller than P over N? If, or let's say, is this generally larger or smaller than the in-sample risk? Larger, right? Because out-of-sample prediction is harder. We could think of it that way because we actually use the training points to fit the estimate itself. Okay, so let's run through the analysis. It should hopefully should complete it kind of quickly. So we're going to assume this model, okay, where xi is random, and epsilon I is normal 0 sigma squared, and these are iid. Okay, and the predictor distribution for right now, the distribution of the x's, we're going to not specify. And as we said already, the predictors and the errors will be independent. Now, there are other ways to analyze the least squares estimator without assuming that. In fact, Larry did that in one of the first lectures of this course. So by all means, you can do this other ways. But this is maybe the easiest, and it'll be a nice preview as to what we're going to get in high dimensional, or nice, you know, kind of motivation for what we're going to be looking at in high dimensional situations. So OK, let's just go for it. So let's condition on x first and look at the in-sample risk conditional on the predictors. OK, so the predictors are fixed. And because epsilon and x are independent, the errors are still normal 0 sigma squared. So everything's good. Remember, this was actually the, we knew what beta was, right? This was equal to x times x transpose x inverse x transpose y. This was this part, right? X transpose x inverse x transpose y was beta hat. And x, we're just multiplying in front here again. Okay, conditioning on x. And now I'm going to make something kind of a very quick remark that's spelled out in a bit more details in the notes. But this is actually an unbiased estimator of this guy, okay, x beta 0. Once we condition on x, we take the expectation, right, then you can see that the expectation of y, right, given x we know is x beta naught. If we multiply this projection matrix by x beta naught, we get back x beta naught, because we're projecting x beta naught onto the column space of x, but it doesn't change. It's already laid in the column space of x. Or other, you can think about it kind of more algebraically. If I stick in the mean there for y, then this x transpose x cancels out with this one. I'm just left with x beta naught. So now we've just said that, you know, once we condition on x, this is an unbiased estimator of the mean parameter. So what are we looking at here? We're really looking at are the sum of the marginal variances, right? This is the sum of squares of some estimator around its mean. So we can write that as 1 over n times the trace of the covariance matrix, or the variance-covariance matrix of this estimator, x times x transpose x inverse times x transpose y. Because, as in words again, we're looking at the sum of the marginal variances of this estimator, some of the variances of the components of this estimator. So I'm just taking the covariance matrix and taking the trace of some of the diagonal entries. I can still conditional on x. OK, and now, you know, property of, for example, covariance is that it's bilinear. So we can take out, for example, let's just call this P of x, as we did before, projection on the column space of x. So I can write this as the trace of, you know, P of x times the covariance of matrix of y given x times P of x. But what's the covariance matrix of y? Sigma squared times the identity. Right? So what we really have is sigma squared times the identity times P of x. Again, x is everything I guess we don't even need to condition anymore because we've actually, there's nothing, no expectation of covariance anymore in this expression. Yeah. And, okay, multiplying by the identity matrix doesn't do anything. Projection matrices are idempotent. If we multiply two projection matrices, then we get back that are the same, right? We get back just one copy of it. You can also check that algebraically. So this is equal to sigma squared over n times the trace of this projection matrix, which is, what do you guys think that is? Projection matrix onto a p-dimensional subspace. It has trace P. You can think about that, again, in various ways. One way is that I can maybe go over here and play this cyclic trace game. So this is the projection matrix whose trace I want to take. I can cycle around the X transpose. And I get X transpose X times X transpose X inverse. P-dimensional identity matrix. Okay. Another way you can think about it is that a projection matrix has eigenvalues all ones and zeros. Okay, and the number of non-zero eigenvalues is the rank of that projection matrix. So if I'm projecting onto p-dimensional subspace, there has to just be p non-zero eigenvalues. But I told you that they're all ones and zeros, right? So that means that the sum of its eigenvalues, which is its trace, is just P. So that was maybe another way to check that. OK, but there's our answer. And note, this didn't depend on x. So once I take an expectation over x as well, if I integrate out over x, the same bound holds. So this is the n-sample risk. Sigma squared times P over n. OK, really quickly. Oh, yeah, question. Well, I mean, x is fixed here, right?
Yeah,
so
in the diagonal, you're going to have this extra element of xi transpose theta squared. But so, there's going to be an extra additive part.
Right, but if that thing's not random, then it doesn't change the variance, right? If I tell you the variance of a random variable is, you know, sigma squared, and I add a constant to it, it's still sigma squared because we've conditioned on x. Other questions? OK. Let's do out-of-sample risk really quickly. Analysis is actually very similar. And what we're going to do now is we're going to condition on the predictors and on the new point. Okay, and we're going to assume that the errors are all independent of the predictors, like we did before. So just like we, OK, it should be a squared here. Just like we argued before, right, fixing x0 for the moment, this thing is an unbiased estimator of this thing, right? Because the mean of this is actually just simply equal to this thing. Okay, we can check that very simply just by plugging in the estimate of the regression coefficients. So what this is then, it's the variance, right? Of this thing, considering the predictors that we use for training and the new point for prediction as fixed. And OK, now we can just, again, remind ourselves what that is. And use the, again, the property. This is a one-dimensional estimator, right? But we can, again, use the property of the variance and write this as x0 transpose x inverse, x transpose times the variance covariance matrix of y. Okay, actually, yeah, this is fine. Which is just sigma squared times the identity matrix times this transpose, right, which is x, x transpose, x inverse, times x0. Okay, and now sigma squared comes out. Identity matrix doesn't matter. Say this cancels with that. And what we get is that this is equal to sigma squared times x0 transpose, x inverse, x0. So that's the out-of-sample risk conditional on x and x0. What is different about this than the in-sample risk? If I take an expectation, does this depend on the location of the training points? Or that this does, right? So does this depend on the distribution of the training points and the predictor point? It generally will, right? We can also, I think actually a nice way to write this is to rewrite this as, so let's take an expectation actually first, without conditioning on anything anymore. This is simply equal to sigma squared times the expectation of, so I'm going to actually write this as, rewrite this as the trace of x0 transpose times x transpose x inverse. So what I did is I wrote this as, so this is just a number. So it's the trace is equal to this number, right? It's the trace of a 1-by-1 matrix. But once I take the trace, I can actually pivot around this x0 here. So this is the same. And I've just taken an expectation to get rid of the conditioning on x and x0. So that's the out-of-sample risk. And now because of independence, okay, I can actually write this as a product of expectations. Expectation of, let's put the trace on the outside even. Sigma squared times the trace of the expectation of x0 transpose times the expected value of x transpose x inverse. Right, because of the independence of the prediction point and the training point. And now look, this is the predictor covariance matrix. This is the expectation of the inverse of the sample covariance matrix of the predictors. And we take the sum of the diagonals of those two matrix products. That is our out-of-sample risk. That we can definitely see, now this is going to depend on the distribution of the predictors, right? Because this is the predictor covariance matrix, so it's certainly going to play a role. Here is one very simple fact. I actually never learned this in my regression class when I was a student. And I would hate to call this new, because I think this is certainly not new. But I did not find this in a standard textbook. I think it must be known. But basically, it is always the case that this thing is larger than or equal to p squared over n, sigma squared p over n, no matter the predictor distribution. So we can show that no matter what the distribution of the predictors is, the out-of-sample risk is never going to be smaller than the in-sample risk. And that comes from a very simple fact. It's kind of like a Jensen's inequality for matrices. Okay, so these, you guys know what Jensen's inequality is, right? The expected value of a convex function of a random variable is larger than or equal to the convex function of the expectation of that random variable. There's a kind of like something similar for matrix inverses, which I found in this old Biometrica paper. By Groves and Rothenberg. In 1969, which tells you that this guy, let's write like this, x transpose x inverse, the expected value of x transpose x inverse minus the expected value of x transpose x inverse for any IID collection of random vectors on the rows of this x is always PSD. It's always a PSD matrix. Yeah, I think about this kind of like a Jensen's inequality, but for matrices, because here we're taking the expected value of something like a convex function applied to this matrix. And here we're taking that same function applied to the expectation of the matrix. And this is a matrix ordering. It means that this is a PSD matrix, this difference. So OK, now let's just call sigma the covariance matrix of the predictors. OK, it's completely arbitrary. And we're going to assume that sigma is positive definite. Otherwise, this doesn't really make sense. And the out-of-sample risk, right? Let's just continue on from here. This is going to be equal to sigma squared times the trace of sigma, the predictor covariance matrix, times the expected value of x transpose x inverse. Now, from this fact, this is less than bigger than or equal to sigma squared times the trace of sigma times the expected value of x transpose x inverse. Sorry? This here? That's the sigma. It's the predictor covariance matrix. Sorry, yeah.
Okay.
Not sure how to make that more of a sigma, but that's supposed to be a sigma. Right? So because this is a PSD, the trace of any matrix product with this is going to be bigger than or equal to the trace of any matrix product with this matrix. Okay, so it's bigger than or equal to trace of sigma times the inverse of the expected value of x transpose x. But what is this thing? This thing over n is sigma. Right? So this thing is actually equal to 1 over n times the trace of sigma inverse. Because in the inside here, this is equal to, actually, this is equal to sigma times n. Because the expected value of x transpose x over n is sigma. So then we get 1 over n from inverting it, and sigma inverse from inverting it. And the trace of these two matrix products is just p. So this is sigma squared p over n. So out-of-sample prediction is always harder than in-sample prediction. It's no easier. Is that standard? Larry, do you know if this is? Yeah. Well, somebody can. You can't publish this. It's so small. But somebody can claim that this is the first place we ever saw this. All right, so that was just against the motivation, because we're going to do out-of-sample and in-sample risk for high-dimensional regression. And this is what it looks like in the low-dimensional case. And even you can make this more precise. For example, if x has Gaussian rows, if we think that the distribution of the x's is Gaussian, then we can actually compute this explicitly without bounding it. And you can see, again, it's smaller. It's bigger than sigma squared p over n. Yeah, that's in the notes, but it's not that important. So you're saying for normal, it's still the case?
Yeah.
Yeah. So if right. So let's suppose that the x zeros and the x i's were drawn from this distribution. Then the in-sample error is still, based on what we computed before, sigma squared p over n. It didn't depend on the distribution of the predictors, and the out-of-sample risk you can actually compute is sigma squared p over n minus p minus 1. So it's a simple calculation. So maybe a bit interesting that even in the normal case, there's a difference between these two. OK. So let's talk about, if there's no questions, why we don't use least squares in high dimensions. because you know a lot about least squares from previous classes, and it's certainly a it's certainly well studied, and statisticians know a lot about it, and we like it as well. I guess we can just start right here. Okay, so when p is larger than n, this thing does not have a unique minimizer anymore, because that implies that x has a non-trivial null space. So this means so x is column rank deficient, which means that there is, I'm not sure what I call the nodes, but let's just say there is some v that's not 0. There's some vector v that's not 0, such that xv is 0, which means that if beta hat is a solution, then beta hat plus any constant times v is also a solution. Why? Because if I multiply this by x, it gives me the same thing, right? This is x beta hat plus c times xv, but xv was 0. So these two actually have the same, they achieve the same value of this criterion. Okay, so that's why we don't use it in high dimensions, because there's not a unique solution. What are the implications of that? Well, there's kind of two problems that poses. I mean, there's probably more than that, but here are two things to think about. The first is that we have no way to interpret the least squares coefficients anymore. Okay, so the first problem is interpretation. So if you give me a solution, let's say you give me a least squares solution beta hat, okay, and I'm interested in interpreting its signs. Like this variable, once I adjust for the other variable, contributes in a positive predictive effect for the response, right? Some way like that. That's how we would interpret the signs of the coefficients that we fit. But we know that there is, so we know that there is some v such that xv is 0, but v is not 0. Okay, and let's just say in particular vj is not 0. Okay, because it has to have at least one non-zero component. Then if beta hat is positive in the jth component, then I can also find a solution with, I call it beta tilde, with a negative jth component. Why? Because let's suppose for simplicity, right, let's suppose vj was positive. We know it's non-zero. Then I'll just take beta tilde to be beta hat minus a really big number times v. Right, big enough to make the jth component negative. So I'll flip the sign of the regression coefficient. This will still be a solution. Okay, so maybe just write like this. Cv for very large positive c. So we can never interpret the least squares coefficients in high dimensions. The other problem is prediction. And by this, I mean out-of-sample prediction. Okay. First of all, in-sample prediction still makes sense, because x beta hat is actually still uniquely defined. This is still just the projection onto the column space of x times y. That's still a uniquely defined object. So our estimates for the means of y still make sense. But what is that, generally speaking, when p is larger than n? What is that going to be? If I have, let's say I have 100 observations and I have thousands of features, generally, this would be just y, right? Because the predictors will span all of Rn. The predictors of the variables span all of Rn, so I'll get a perfect fit. OK, so that's kind of useless, but that it is still unique. Out of sample does no longer make sense, because this is no longer unique. So this is unique. It's well defined. This is not unique. This, of course, is going to generally depend on which one I choose. If I choose beta hat versus beta tilde, they give me different out-of-sample predictions. So those are the two problems, prediction and interpretation. We can't do either, which maybe is what we're used to doing with you know, least squares estimators, high dimensions. OK, and the last comment is that even if well defined, so even if we're not in high dimensions, but p is large relative to n, like let's say p is still less than n, but it's quite large, the risk of sigma squared p over n, this could be bad, right? We derive those risk bounds. They look like sigma squared p over n. Even if this is all well defined, you know, let's say we can do out of sample prediction and it's close to this, or in sample prediction is equal to this, this could be bad, especially when p is large, right? Let's suppose p scales like n over 2. And we don't even have a consistent estimator anymore. The risk is just sigma squared over 2. What is this caused by? What is the problem with least squares? Why is the risk high when p is large? So there's only like really two things you can answer, bias and variance, right? Because we talked about the bias-variance decomposition many times. Is it the bias or the variance that's hurting it? It's the variance. We actually saw it was unbiased. That's how we derived the risk bounds. So the variance is too high. Is there a question?
Yeah. Is the chance of Px still in this space?
Sorry?
The chance of Px, the projection matrix, is still P or
the trace. Yeah, the trace is the rank of the projection matrix. No, because if p is much larger than n, then it'll be projecting onto an n-dimensional subspace.
So risk is no non-parity squared.
Yeah, this was maybe not very clear, but I said even if it's well defined. So let's suppose that we're still actually in a low-dimensional case, and it's well defined. Then we still may not want to use least squares, because this could actually be kind of separate but related point. Good question. OK, other questions? All right. I think actually it makes sense to take a very quick break, and then we'll come back and we'll just start doing high dimensional estimation. So we'll take a few minute break. What do we do to the least squares estimator? We just said that the problem was variance, so we have to reduce the variance somehow. So we regularize, right? That's something that we do. We've seen a lot. Let's go over here. So now we're going to be thinking about, I guess, in two forms. And by the way, nothing that we said really so far is specific to least squares. The theory is cleanest for least squares, but the same idea applies to low-dimensional parametric model. Like if you loved logistic regression, it would be the same idea. you know, the properties of logistic regression in low dimensions and the failures of logistic regression in high dimensions, and also the fixes. It's just that we're looking at least squares, or looking at regression because it's, you know, linear models, because it's kind of cleanest to work in this setting. So two different ways. One is maybe we could call constrained form. So we're going to be thinking about restricting the parameter space when we're doing estimation. And this would reduce the variance, right? Because then our parameter estimates cannot ever leave C. So if C was some compact set, certainly that would help reduce the variance at the expense of possibly increasing bias, right? Because now we can't estimate every mean parameter. We can only estimate mean or coefficient. We can only estimate coefficients that are in C. An equivalent form, at least if C was a convex set, is something like this. Okay, we would penalize the least squares criterion using some penalty function p, and that we might call that penalized form. And as I said, these are dual notions to each other. They're equivalent in a sense that we'll kind of make clear if C is a convex set and p is a convex function, there's dual notions. Okay, so the next section just says that there's section 1.4, I'm just going to skip. It says that I'm only going to talk about a kind of very specific slice of high-dimensional estimation, which is high-dimensional regression, specifically high-dimensional regression surrounding the lasso. And that's not the full story at all, and there's lots of other things that you could learn, and I gave some references there for some books that you might want to take a look at. So let's think about three norms. Tale of three norms. Usually, we think about C being defined by a norm ball. Okay, so this would be something like the norm of beta is constrained to be less than or equal to some tuning parameter, or P is actually a norm. That's a very general canonical form of regularization. And of course, the three norms that we'll think about are L0, L1, and L2. Okay, and we're going to think about those, what we get out of those three choices. So, okay, in constrained form, let's start with constrained form. Let's just save some space on the blackboard by writing the problems all kind of on top of each other. We could think about basically constraining our estimates to have, for example, L0 norm less than or equal to some tuning parameter. And here I'll call the tuning parameter k, because the L0 norm, whose definition is in the notes, but I think you guys all remember by now, is the sum of the non-zero elements, the number of non-zero elements in beta. So for example, if beta has 5 non-zeros, the L0 norm is just 5. So it makes sense to keep k to be an integer, this parameter being an integer. And what's that called? That's called best subset selection, which, again, I'm pretty sure you guys have seen before. The L1 norm, right, if we constrain this according to the L1 norm, then, again, the definition of this is in the notes, but you've seen it lots throughout the semester and other courses. This is the sum of the absolute values of beta. We constrain based on that. And here I'll use t as the tuning parameter because it no longer necessarily needs to be integral. This is, of course, called the lasso, which you guys have seen, which I invented when I was 11. But somebody stole it from me and published it. I didn't invent it, of course, but somebody in this room did. And then we can think about the last one as the L2 norm being constrained, and that's called ridge regression. Or sometimes you might hear these go by different names, but this is what we call them in statistics, and I have references in the notes for some of the, you know, for those of you who want to look at the original papers. Okay, in penalized form, I won't write it down because just basically substitute these norms for this penalty, multiply it now by a parameter called lambda, rather than having a bound parameter, which we called t for the L1 and L2 norm and the k for the L0 norm. Okay. Actually, you know what? I take that back. I will write it down. I will write it down because I wanted to make one point, one kind of quick point. So let's just do that. One quick point. So that was constrained form. This is going to be penalized form. I'm going to put a half in front of the least squares loss. That's just for convenience. Of course, it's really of no consequence because we could just change the tuning parameter accordingly. And we'll do the same thing kind of that we did here. I'll zero norm we get penalized by. L1 norm or the L2 norm. And we actually always pretty much use the L2 norm squared because this thing is then smooth. The whole loss is smooth. But it doesn't really matter. Both are equivalent to constrained form. So I'll make that point now. So this is equivalent to the one norm constraint. This is equivalent to the two norm constraint in the sense that if you gave me a solution to this problem, let's pick the last one bound form, for some parameter t, there is a lambda such that that value of beta also solves this penalized problem. Okay, I'm not telling you which lambda it is, but there's a correspondence between the bound parameter and the penalty parameter that makes the solution to those two problems the same. Likewise, this is equivalent to the bound form of ridge regression. How about this one? How many people think it's equivalent? I guess I put it in the notes, so you guys were all reading carefully. But it's not equivalent. And that's actually because the original problem is not convex. And there's actually, in a sense, a one-sided relationship between these two problems, in that for every value of lambda, there's a corresponding value of t such that the solutions to this problem are solutions to that problem, but not vice versa. Okay, sometimes I might constrain, for example, the L0 norm to have, let's say, 7 non-zero coefficients. And I cannot find a value of lambda that will give me 7 non-zero coefficients. It'll jump from 6 to 8 as I change lambda. Okay? So they're not equivalent. So I mean, in some sense, they're different problems, but we can't really solve them anyways. So I guess we don't tend to make that such a big deal. I'll discuss a bit more about that in a second. OK, so now we have 10 minutes left. Let me tell you some properties that differentiate these problems. So the first is going to be sparsity. So two of these norms are different than the third in the sense that they induce sparsity in the estimated coefficients. So the solutions to these problems, either in bound or penalized form, in constrained or penalized form, gives us sparsity. So L0 and L1, they induce sparsity in the solutions beta hat. And it depends on what version you're looking at. Let's just pick one. Let's just look at constrained form. It's super clear, it's very natural, that as k is smaller, the best subset selection solution is more sparse. That's just by definition, right? By construction. When k is 2, there are just 2 non-zeros by construction in the best subset selection solution. As we make t smaller, it's not quite as clear that actually we're getting sparsity, but we actually we will get sparsity in the lasso estimator. And there are various ways to look at that, and we'll talk about a few. And the direction is, as t is gets smaller, we get more sparsity. With rich regression, there's no such behavior. So the L2 norm as a regularizer, it's generically non-sparse. So in general, the solution will have all non-zero coefficients. So that actually, in a sense, divides these two norms, these three norms, drastically into two different camps. Why is sparsity nice? It's nice for multiple reasons. But if we go back to the reasons we talked about here, it's nice for interpretation because setting one of the components of the estimated coefficients to zero is akin to performing variable selection in the linear model. It's saying that that particular variable, right, if beta j was estimated to be zero, then we're saying that xj plays no predictive role given the other variables in predicting the mean of y. So it helps us interpret in a succinct way the predictive roles of those variables. And then there's other reasons maybe why it might be nice, and those have to do with predictions, but that's kind of somehow less, maybe less obvious because L2 regularized estimates can predict well too. It's not necessarily that we need a sparse estimator to make good predictions, but certainly if we believe that the underlying model was sparse, if the mean was generated by a sparse combination of x's, then introducing sparsity into the estimates would help in terms of prediction. Here?
Up there.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. So how do we see that we get sparsity? Well, I have to give this picture because it's the classic picture. And then maybe I'll just kind of move on to convexity very quickly. But this is the classic picture for why you get sparsity with an L1 constraint versus an L2 constraint. And as we said, the L0 constraint giving us sparsity is natural, right? There's no explanation needed for that. And I, if I'm not mistaken, this was in the original Lasso paper. So this is a Tibshirani original artwork, but it seems to be used a lot. So what we do is we think about the constrained versions in two dimensions. So let's just fix p equals 2 for pictorial reasons. I can't draw more than two dimensions. And we think about the L1 norm constraint. So this is beta 1. This is beta 2. This is the set of all vectors beta 1, beta 2 that have L1 norm less than or equal to something, right? Whatever this value is here, t. And then we think about the, let's suppose these are the least squares estimates. This is the least squares solution. So for the moment, we think about this being well-defined just for this intuition. And we draw the contours of the least squares loss around this point. So this is where the least squares loss is minimized. The least squares loss then is a quadratic, right? So it's going to come out around that point like bull in two dimensions. And we're going to draw the contours. These are like taking slices of constant height through that bull. So as we move out on the contours, right, the least squares loss gets higher and higher. The solution is the first place that one of these contours touches this constraint set. Because once that happens, then we've made the loss as small as possible, right? Because we're moving out in the direction of increasing the loss until we hit the constraint set. So the loss is made as small as possible subject to lying in the constraint set. And the picture is that because the L1 norm has corners, we tend to hit a corner of the L1 norm, which gives or vertex of the of L1 norm ball, which gives us sparsity in the solution. Okay, because here beta 2 is set to be 0. The corresponding picture for the L2 norm suggests that because the L2 norm does not have corners, but has smooth parts that protrude out from the coordinate axes, we won't get sparsity. Right? Generically, this will touch the contour somewhere outside of the coordinate axes. And then I think, was it Ben Recht or was it Joel Tropp?
Joel Tropp.
Joel Tropp had a nice way of looking at this in high dimensions. Well, actually, the number of vertices of the L1 ball is very high, but so are the number of low-dimensional faces. So there are lots of opportunities, essentially, to get active sets or solutions with sparsity levels smaller than P, because there are lots of low-dimensional faces of the L1 ball. So the way that Joel Tropp has drawn this, maybe in a talk or something, is that you can think about, in high dimensions, the L1 ball really looks like that. Its corners really stick out. Of course, that's not really true because it's still a convex set, but it has lots of low-dimensional faces. So in a sense, there's a lot of, it's very pointy. There's a lot of chances for the contours of a smooth loss function like the least squares loss to hit one of the low-dimensional faces. So in other words, the least squares coefficients can have different signs than the lasso coefficients. So it doesn't need to necessarily preserve the signs. I think actually we're going to cover that next time. So that's a picture of why you get sparsity intuitively. I had something in the notes about the orthogonal case where you can derive the solutions to these three problems explicitly. And you can also see that in the orthogonal case, when X is an orthogonal matrix, you get sparsity as you vary lambda in these two problems, but not in this one. The components of the solution are always non-zero. So next time, we'll talk about the other property that differentiates these three norms, which is convexity. OK, and if we were to cross out one norm for convexity, which one would we be crossing out? That would be the L0 norm. So that doesn't have a property of convexity. OK, I'll see you guys on Thursday.